Next question is from Michitech. How do you adjust your clients' macros when they are consistently non-compliant?
More good questions. Yeah.
This is a good one even for just for yourself. So as a trainer, this is something that it took me a little while to learn, but I had to realize that what I thought the client was getting in terms of value sometimes was inaccurate. In other words, if I had somebody show up and train with me twice a week, and they were still eating like crap, they weren't working out on their own, they weren't following my advice when they weren't around, I would get very frustrated early on. And sometimes I'd think to myself, I'm not going to train this client anymore. Fuck it. But then I realized something. They're coming 2 days a week. That 2 days a week with me is way more than what they would be doing without me. So there is some value that they're getting. And so when you have clients that are non-compliant, back off. It's not time to talk about nutrition.
Yeah.
You know?
Sometimes too, part of the non-compliance is, this is what I have found, that sometimes we throw too much at the client too soon.
So often.
Yeah. And you get somebody who has no idea about nutrition and doesn't care about macros, and that's why they hired you, is they want you to do most of the work for them. And like your job, I really like this question because this is actually more common than you would think. We all talk about, breaking down macros and what's the best diet all day long. But this type of question is what I really like because this is real life right here. This is what really normally happens is you get a client who's just, the reason why they're way out of shape is because they don't give a shit about this stuff and they don't want to take the discipline and time to do that. And so as a trainer, you had to learn ways to get creative. Like, how do I get this person to become compliant that just fails every time I give them a diet, they won't follow it? So you need to learn to give them much smaller, simpler goals and build upon that. And this is how the evolution of adding to the diet instead of subtracting started for me. Mm-hmm. I had such a hard time of taking someone completely change their diet.
And it sounds so counter, right? Like you're adding things?
Right, yeah. And we're talking about a weight loss person, right? Somebody who needs to lose 100 pounds, and here your trainer isn't saying, no, don't have McDonald's, no, don't do that. I'm not telling them any of that shit. I'm saying, I want you to have this every day. Can we commit to that? And so, we use vegetables to start with, but I would build upon that. So a lot of times somebody who eats a lot of bad food is eating a lot of processed stuff, doing a lot of fast food. They're not getting a lot of their vegetables and fruits. So that always would be the first like easy one and be like, can you commit to me to having like, just, I don't want you to worry about anything else. Just can you add a cup of berries a day? Or can you add one giant salad every single day? And they're like, okay, yeah, I could do that. And that's all we speak to, until they're consistent with that and they're constantly doing that. And what ends up happening is when they do that, it ends up replacing something else in the diet that was probably not as good for them as that cup of berries or that big ass
and
salad.
And they make that decision themselves. You don't have to take anything
out. You're not taking anything from them. And then once I get them doing that consistently, then I go like, okay, I have a new challenge for us. This is what I want us to do. Again, I'm not going to tell you can't have any of these things, but can we commit to eating 12 ounces total a day of a lean meat? You can choose chicken, you can do fish, you can do turkey. I just want to commit to 12 ounces. Basically, two times in the day, you're going to eat a meat that's a lean meat. And okay, yeah, I could do that. Mm-hmm. And so you get them to do that. And then next thing you know, that's now replacing something else that would not be ideal for it. And you start to build in these better habits and you're kind of tricking the client into getting them into eating and having better eating behaviors and a better relationship with food. And it's a very clever way to do it without them feeling like they're having to follow this diet.
People need to realize just how brilliant what you're saying is. And this is why when I go and I talk to trainers and try to communicate to them how to become better trainers, the thing I focus on is communication. Because what Adam is saying might be counter. You might be thinking they need to take all the garbage out of their diet. They need to reduce their calories. But it doesn't work. And I don't mean it doesn't work in the sense that if they did that, it wouldn't work. Of course, if they did that, it would work. But that doesn't work because people don't do that.
Right.
It's a very ineffective way of communicating how to change your nutrition. What Adam's saying is a much more effective way of communicating to get people to change their nutrition. And so that's a great point that you bring up. Maybe your clients are non-compliant because the way you're selling it is wrong.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what you're doing. You're selling better nutrition to your client. And when someone buys it, they have to buy it.
I wish there was a sort of a belt system like they have in martial arts and for trainers, because I could identify them right away based off their mentality with their client of what they're trying to achieve with their client.
Right.
Versus like being a behavioral manager.
Right.
And why we always stress, you know, the point of all these things like processed food, what worries us about that, you know, and, you know, artificial sugars and all these types of things that, yes, on paper and in lab settings, you know, you can make arguments for, you know, it doesn't do much harm, versus what we actually see in our clients' behaviors and how it alters that. And like, how can we can peer into that that client even further and see what the domino sequence is going to be after that. And so if you present them with that really impactful domino ahead of time, maybe it's, you have to like really put the work upon yourself to reduce, you know, the amount of information that you've received over, you know, decades going through, you know, fitness and health and nutrition knowledge, and what you can present then that's going to have the most impact without any of the confusion alongside.
No, very, very well said. Extremely well said. And that's, I think, the most absolute most important thing is how can, and do this for yourself. Here's a big one. This is a very, very big one now. Patience. I had to learn patience as a personal trainer.
Yeah.
I had a guy who I trained who wanted to lose 50 pounds, and it took him 3 years to lose 35 pounds. 3 years. Now, you know what happened after he lost that 35 pounds in 3 years? Took him another 6 months to lose the rest of the weight, and then he never gained it back.
Hmm.
Now, the old version of me, the new, when I was the new trainer, that would have been way too slow. You need to make this happen. Got to do this. But then I started to understand, look, we're dealing with behaviors that take a long time. This person's had these behaviors for decades. And I'm trying to change that in a month. You know, I'm going to be a little bit more patient. I'm going to take my time. And sometimes they're not ready to talk about macros and nutrition. That's okay, because you're here working out with me, and it's better than doing nothing at all. And treat yourself this way. So if you're not a trainer, this applies to you as well. If you're trying to change your eating habits, if you're trying to become more consistent with your workouts, be patient and take your time with it and start slow. And that's really the only way to find long-term success, at least for the majority of people I've ever worked with.